Welcome to another edition of ProSoft Technologies video training. In this edition, we'll be covering the process for configuring the MVI56E-MCM as a master communicating with a slave device over a Modbus network. Now, if you're unfamiliar with any of the Modbus terminology or topics like function codes or Modbus data addressing, ProSoft Technology has a training video that covers the basics of understanding the Modbus protocol that might be helpful. The MVI56E Enhanced Modbus Master-Slave Communication Module allow Rockwell Automation ControlLogix processors to easily interface with devices using the Modbus RTU ASCII Serial Communications Protocol. The MVI56E-MCM and MVI56E-MCM-XT feature two independently configurable serial ports that can be configured as a Modbus master or slave, sharing the same user-controlled 10,000-word database. An Ethernet port is also provided for debugging. In this video, we'll install the add-on profile and add-on instruction for the MCM. We'll go through the process to configure the MCM as a Modbus master and then set up master commands to talk to a power monitor. We'll create a command to read the minimum and maximum levels for phase A voltage. We'll write a voltage limit for phase A. Then we'll write some bits to reset the minimum and maximum voltage for phase A. This is the node of the power monitor I'll be working with and the addresses that I'll be using. We'll start by installing the latest add-on profile for the ProSoft family of products. You can download a copy of the AOP off the product disk or by going to our website at www.prosoft-technology.com and going to the MVI56E-MCM product page. Be sure to also grab the sample ladder file for the MVI56E-MCM. We'll be using this a little later. To install the add-on profile, double-click on MP Setup and follow the prompts to complete the installation. Be sure that all Rockwell software is closed when you do this, including RS links. Once this is done, we'll open up RSLogix 5000. You can also use Studio 5000. I have a new project already set up. We'll bring the MVI56E-MCM into the project by expanding the I/O configuration in the controller organizer. Right-click on the 1756 backplane and select New Module. In the Select Module screen, clear the vendor filters and then select ProSoft. Then go down and choose the MVI56E-MCM module. Click Create in the New Module window. Give the module a name. I'm going to name it My MCM. The slot number should be the slot the MCM occupies in your rack. And click OK. Next, we'll import the MVI56E-MCM add-on instruction ladder to get the processor talking to the module. In the Controller Organizer window, expand Tasks and drill down to Main Program and double-click on Main Routine. Once the main routine opens, right-click on any rung and select Import Rung. Then browse for and select the .l5x add-on rung file and click Import. When the import configuration window opens, change the slot number by modifying the local slot number field to match the number of the slot that the MVI56E-MCM is actually using. In this case, I have the module in slot 2 of my rack, so I'll change each field to slot 2. Once this is done, click OK, return to main routine, and delete the empty rung 0. Now the user-defined data types imported with the add-on rung are listed in the data types section of the controller organizer tree, as you can see here. And this also brings in the ladder logic and controller tags for the MCM module. The MVI56E-MCM module has a database of 10,000 registers. Typically, you can think of this database as having two sections, read data and write data. The read data is sent to the ControlLogix CPU from the network, while the write data is read from the ControlLogix CPU and then sent out over the network. To configure the MCM's database, we'll use the mcm.config.moddef controller tag. The moddef tag configures the entire module's database, and I'll go through the essential entries here. The write start register defines where within the MCM's database the write data from the ControlLogix CPU will begin. In this example, the data will start at 0. So that would be the very first register of the entire database. The write register count parameter specifies the number of registers that will be allocated to the write data from the ControlLogix CPU to the MVI56E-MCM. In the example, the count is set to 600 registers. I'll go down to the read start register, and this specifies the starting register in the MCM module, where data will be transferred from the network to the module and then sent on to the processor. In this case, the read registers will begin at 1000. And the read register count defines the total number of registers the MCM will write to the ControlLogix CPU. Again, the count is set here to 600 registers. So with this configuration, the database would look something like this. And once we've finished configuring the module's database, we can move on to configuring the MCM's serial ports. And we'll do this by going to the mcm.config.port1 and port 2 controller tags. I'll only be using port 1 for this training video. So under the mcm.config.port1, I'll set enabled to 1. This will enable serial port 1 on the MCM. Next, with type set to 0, the port will be a Modbus master. Entering a 1 here would set the port as a slave. Next, I'll set the baud rate to 19200, parity to 0, data bits to 8, and stop bits to 1. These settings must all match those of the slave devices on the Modbus network that you'll be connecting to. And I can now begin adding Modbus master commands. Each port on the MVI56E-MCM has a master command controller tag for creating master commands. For port 1, the tag is at mcm.config.port1master command. And here we can create up to 325 commands for the port. I'll create a few commands to illustrate how different commands work with our database configuration. And note that you'll need to consult the user manual for your slave device in order to know what addresses in that device you would want to read and write data to. I've done this for my power monitor, so I'll begin by setting up a master command to read the minimum and maximum phase A voltage. Expand mcm.config.port1master command 0, and under enable, I'll type a 1, which sets the command to run continuously. Next, I'll enter an internal address of 1000. This is where the return data will be placed in the MCM database, which is the starting address for the read data portion of our internal database. Each of the two numbers I'm going to read will be float values, which, due to the limitations of the Modbus protocol, require 2 16-bit registers each. So I'll move down to count and enter 4 as the number of registers I want to use. I'll select node 1 as the device to give the command to. A function code of 3 means to read multiple holding registers, and a device address of 1024 means we'll start reading registers from address 41,025 in our power monitor, which is where the values for phase A voltage that I'm trying to read are kept. And that does it for the command. Now, our floats will each be divided into 2 16-bit words when they are read into the database. And we won't be able to view them properly unless we go through an extra step to convert them back into a 32-bit floating point number. And we'll go through that process now. So looking at the controller tags, we'll click on the Edit tab. And what we need to do is create a real data array that we can copy our two pairs of words into. This will allow them to be displayed as floating point numbers. Click on a blank row and enter a name. I'll call this real data. The name can be anything you like. We'll set the data type to real and dimensions to 2, since I only have 2 float values that I want to read. Click OK. Now that we have the array, we need some ladder logic to copy the words from our read data to our new real data array. We'll go back to main routine and add a rung. On the new rung, we'll add a ladder element. In the window that pops up, go down to File, Miscellaneous, and select Copy File. Click OK and the copy element will appear in the ladder. We'll click on the source field and we'll drill down to the read data and select the tags that our read command will place the data into. This will be starting at read data 0. The destination will, of course, be our real data array, starting at real data 0. The length, in this case, will be 2, since length always refers to the number of tags in the destination array. So if we were going to do this same process backwards, and copy the two float values to a 16-bit integer array, the length would be 4 to accommodate that data. And we'll verify the routine. So we should be ready to download the configuration to the processor now. I'll go up to Communication, select Who Active. On the screen, I'll look in my Ethernet connections, locate the Ethernet module in the ControlLogix rack. I'll open up the backplane and select the processor and click Download. And then click Download again on the Download screen. And once the download is complete, we're given the option to go online. We'll do that. And if everything's gone to plan, we should have the minimum and maximum voltage data in the mcm.data.readdata. And there it is. And as you can see, it's not anything recognizable as a voltage value. To see that, we'll need to look in our real data array. And there they are. Now, the Modbus protocol does not specify what order the words of double integers or float values should be transmitted in. Different industrial vendors order them differently. If they're read in the wrong order, the data in the MCM will not appear properly. If this happens, all you have to do when you set up the command is enter a 1 for swap. This will swap the word order when you're dealing with 32-bit values. There's also a code for swapping bit order and words and bits. Moving on, I'll create a couple of write commands, one to set the phase A voltage limit and one to reset the minimum and maximum voltage readings that we looked at earlier. I'll set the limit first. Expand mcm.config.port1master command 1. I'll type a 2 for enable, which sets the command to execute conditionally so that it will only write if the data changes, or in this instance, if we write a new value. I'll enter an internal address of 0, which is where the register will be written from in the MCM's database. This is also the starting address for the MCM's write data section. I'll enter 1 as the number of registers I want to use, and I'll select node 1 as the device to give this command to. I'll use function code 6 to write a single holding register. Finally, a device address of 50 means I'll write the registers to slave address 40,051, which is the register where the limit for phase A voltage is stored in the power monitor. Next, I'll expand mcm.config.port1master command 2. This will be a command to write some bits that will reset the minimum and maximum voltage readings. Under enable, I'll type a 2, so the command runs conditionally. I'll enter an internal address of 160 for return data placement in the database. Now, for the MCM module, anytime you're dealing with a coil or bit level Modbus function code, the internal address for that command must be to the bit level as well. This is a write command, so we're going to the write section of our database. The first command is using the first register in write data, so we need to start at address 2, but I'm going to write these bits from the 11th word, which will be write data 10. We multiply that by 16 to get the bit level address, and that gives us 160. For count, we'll enter 2 as the number of registers we want to use. So that's 2 bits, which will encompass bit 160 and 161. Again, we're addressing node 1. A function code of 15 needs to write multiple coils. The device address will be 1208. This is the bit level address in the power monitor that we want to write to. Now you should know that there are devices that will place the bits to enable and disable functions not in the bit level address range, but in the regular 16-bit holding registers in the 40001 address range. If you find you need to read or write bits in that range, you won't use a bit level function code. You'd use a function code to read or write to the register where the bits you want are situated. So now that my commands are set up, I'll warm boot the module. This will resend the configuration with the new commands to the processor. And once the reboot is complete, we'll go back online. At this point, we should be able to go to mcm.status and look at the pass counter. If it's counting, that tells us that the module is actively communicating with the processor. Now we can write some data to the power monitor to set a limit and reset the minimum and maximum values for phase A voltage. So in our first command, we want to set the limit. We'll drill down to mcm.data.writedata0, which is where we specified we'd be writing from in the command. I'll enter a value of 225 to set the limit in the monitor to 225 volts on phase A. Now, if it goes over this limit, the monitor will send an alert. In the second command, we wanted to set some bits in the power monitor to reset the minimum and maximum values for phase A. I specified the first bit would come from bit address 160 in the MCM's write data array. This means that we'll go to word 10. This will be mcm.data.writedata10. And we'll expand this out and set the first 2 bits here to 1. And these will be bits 160 and 161 in the bit level addressing. These will set the bits in the power monitor to reset the minimum and maximum values. Now once we've done this, we'll probably have to go back and set these bits back to 0 so that the program doesn't just keep resetting those values. And those are the basics of how to set up a MVI56E-MCM Modbus Serial Communication Module. As always, if you have any questions or would like to see more training videos, visit our website at www.prosoft-technology.com. And again, if you'd like to learn more about the Modbus protocol and how to use it, you can check out our video on YouTube, Understanding Modbus. That should do it for this training session. Until next time, happy training.